artificial intelligence, from digital assistants to life-saving drug research, to recommendation systems that are at the heart of our e-commerce, social media, and entertainment worlds. This transformative technology is already impacting our everyday lives, and yet we've only begun to scratch the surface of its potential. In this special three-part series of Architecture All Access, longtime AI evangelist, educator, author, and Intel fellow Andres Roriguez provides an introduction to the efficient training and deployment of deep learning models for commercial applications. This is Architecture All Access.
Hi, I'm Andres Roriguez, and this is Architecture All Access AI Fundamentals. Now, there are a lot of videos out there that talk about AI, but this series is going to be a little different. Yes, we're going to talk about AI, but with a focus on the different types of hardware architectures that are needed to train and deploy AI workloads, from CPUs to GPUs to new custom-built AI accelerators to FPGAs and some of their unique and shared features. Before we talk about these architectures, we'll review some fundamental AI concepts. There are many sub-branches of AI. The one most interesting to us is called machine learning, or ML. ML comprises algorithms that learn functions that map input data to output predictions. In 2012, Professor Geoff Hinton from the University of Toronto popularized neural networks, a class of ML algorithms comfortable winning the ImageNet image classification and detection competition. Since then, neural network innovations have accelerated at a torrid pace. This field of study of neural networks with multiple layers is called deep learning. So, what is a neural network? A neural network is made of a set of layers that map input data to a desired output. For example, we can map or translate sentences in one language to a different language. We can map spectrograms from speech sound to written text, or vice versa, use written text to generate speech. We can map a person's preference to a product recommendation. We can map the attributes of a house and neighborhood to a price. We can map images to a corresponding label, and so on. As I discuss how a neural network works, at first, some parts may sound complicated, but I'm going to explain how this happens. Each layer of a neural network has many units, sometimes called neurons, that apply a simple, nonlinear function to the weighted sum of the values from the previous layer. Training a neural network is simply the iterative process of learning good weights to use for these weighted sums. We'll come back to these weights in a moment. Let's walk through a very simple task, classifying digits from the MNIST dataset. This dataset has 70,000 grayscaled images of handwritten 0 to 9 digits. Each image is 28 by 28, meaning there are 784 pixels per image. We'll use a neural network with four layers. The first, or input layer, has 784 units, corresponding to the number of pixels in each image. The fourth, or last layer, has 10 units, corresponding to the number of classes or digits. The layers in between are called hidden layers. A data scientist gets to experiment with the number of hidden layers and the number of units in these layers. In our network, we'll choose 128 units in layer 2 and 32 units in layer 3. There are techniques to guide the data scientist with the selection of these parameters, but we won't cover those here. We want our neural network to map the input, that is the 784 pixel values, to the respective class. The output of the neural network is a vector with 10 values, each value corresponding to the probability that the input image is the digit 0 to 9. Suppose the input is an image of the digit 4. The output of a well-trained network should produce a value near 1 for the vector index corresponding to the digit 4, and values near 0 for the remaining 9 classes. Training this neural network means finding a good set of weights that successfully accomplishes this mapping. To map the values from layer 1 to layer 2, there are 784 times 128 weights, since layer 2 has 128 units. Similarly, there are 128 times 32 weights in layer 2, and 32 times 10 weights in layer 3. Notice that just the first layer has over 100,000 weights. Some modern large neural networks have over a trillion weights. During the training process, the input values are forward propagated through the network layers to compute the predicted output. The output is compared to the expected output, and a metric of error is computed. We know the expected output because somebody labeled the training samples. The error is then backward propagated through the network in order to know how to adjust these weights to reduce the error. This forward and then backward propagation process is iterated, sometimes millions of times, until the weights stop adjusting. The weights are usually initialized to random values near zero, sampled from a zero mean Gaussian distribution. In the first iteration, the network predictions are very inaccurate. The weights are random, so the output is random. As the weights are adjusted in each iteration, the accuracy typically improves. Now let's dive into some of the computational details to better understand the hardware features that are beneficial for neural networks. The weighted sums across all the units in a layer can be computed in parallel. Typically, these sums are represented as a matrix vector multiplication to use a highly optimized linear algebra library, such as 1DNN or QDNN, so it executes fast on the targeted hardware backend. The matrix contains the set of weights for a given layer, and the output of this multiplication is a vector, which contains the results of all the weighted sums for that layer. The training process can be further parallelized by processing multiple samples at the same time. The input samples or vectors are aggregated into a matrix. Thus, in practice, matrix-matrix multiplications, or GEMMs, are used. GEMM computations can be decomposed into several multiply and accumulate, or MAC, operations, which can execute in parallel. Hardware supporting a high number of MACs per second can be advantageous in the training process. During the backpropagation stage in each training iteration, we need to use the output from each layer that were computed in the forward propagation stage. These values are typically stored in memory after being computed during the forward propagation and read back and used during the backward propagation. Thus, a training iteration involves moving large amounts of data from compute to memory and vice versa. Hardware supporting high bandwidth between the compute units and memory can be advantageous in the training process. In fact, bandwidth is a critical bottleneck across several training workloads. Once training is completed, the network is validated and then deployed to infer the class labels of new data that it was never trained on. This is known as inference or serving. Low latency is critical to most real-world inference applications. Unlike in training, during inference, it is more common to process just one or very few samples at a time, rather than a large batch of samples to meet the latency requirements of the application. This means that for inference, matrix vector multiplications are more common than GEMMs. Matrix vector multiplications still benefit from parallelism, but have less parallelism than GEMMs. Deep learning applications used to be primarily around image classification and other visual tasks. Today, while vision remains the largest workload in edge applications, such as in security cameras, or autonomous vehicles, recommendations and language tasks dominate across the companies with the largest global data centers, sometimes called the hyperscalers. Neural networks, in particular those targeting recommendations and language tasks, are not only growing in the number of weights, but also in their complexity. While older neural networks are typically a chain of sequential layers and the inputs and outputs are of static sizes, neural neural networks have dynamic inputs and output sizes and are adopting a graph structure where the outputs of several non-sequential layers can become the input to another layer. Older neural networks primarily need lots of mags, that is, multiply and accumulate, and high bandwidth memory for training. The computational patterns and memory accesses are predictable, that is, they're known ahead of time. Therefore, it is simpler for the software to pipeline the data to efficiently use the hardware mags. Newer neural networks have more irregular memory access patterns, and in addition to mags and bandwidth, they also require larger memory capacity, high operating frequency for the growing number of non-parallelizable computations, and lower memory read and write latencies across non-sequential memory addresses. Memory and bandwidth are becoming the central components in deep learning system designs, and there are various choices. Hardware-managed memory or caches consume more power. Software-managed memory or scratch patches, typically used in dedicated AI processors or ASICs, increases software complexity. Given the continued exponential growth in mags per silicon area, the memory bandwidth and the bandwidth between nodes within a server and across servers are becoming the limiting factors to improve performance. One way to reduce the memory and bandwidth consumption is to use less bits to represent numbers. There is a push in industry to adopt lower numerical precision formats. The traditional precision in deep learning is 32-bit floating point or single precision. But there is a growing adoption of 16-bit floating point precision for training and inference, and even 8-bit integer for some inference workloads. Some edge applications, where area and power are more constrained, are even adopting 4-bits. Lower numerical precision reduces the memory and bandwidth bottlenecks and enables more mags in a given silicon area. On the other hand, reducing the precision can result in lower accuracy, meaning less accurate predictions. The application engineer needs to consider the trade-offs from the computational gains with the possible accuracy impact. So which hardware is best for neural networks? I'll answer that and more in part 2, Architecture All-Access AI Hardware. I hope you'll join me.